And good afternoon. It's Wednesday the 15th of February 2017. Welcome to today's United Kingdom Talk. All the old Valentine stuff is over now, isn't it, boys and girls? I bet you're glad to see the back of that. I've got to say, I was disappointed with the roses in Waitrose. I was in there yesterday afternoon doing a little bit of shopping with my mate. And we went past these roses. There wasn't actually many left. And I said to the girl who was, adjusting the flowers, "Oh, yes. Oh, yeah, in Waitrose, people are wandering around adjusting shelves, making the flowers look all nice and that. They don't just dump them in like in Aldi. Have you ever seen the plants in Aldi?" Well, I mean, to be honest, if you get them on the first day that they're there, you're probably going to be all right. Okay? Anything longer than that, they sit outside. No one ever waters them. And by the end of the week, these same plants, they bring them, they wheel them back out on the same shelves. They're dead. I mean, after time, all you can see is like a pot of earth described as a rose bush. And there's nothing there. The thing has died. They don't look after their stuff in there. But in Waitrose, they do. And I said to the girl, "Did you have many flowers?" She said, "We had stacks of them. By 1 o'clock, they were all gone." And you remember, if you're watching yesterday's show as well, that I said to you about these special meal for two type, Valentine's meal for two deals, 20 quid or whatever it is. And there were like thousands of calories in these things, thousands and thousands, but it's only once, so it doesn't matter, does it? But they were all sold out by 12:30. I went to my usual vegetable section because, I'm a little bit, a little bit lax in cooking vegetables. I tend to buy one of the packets that you stick a couple of holes in the top and then just shove them in the microwave for 10 minutes or for about 4 minutes, and you just take off the plastic bit and put it in. No good for the environment, of course. It's so much easier than getting out that old steamer, isn't it? It really is. But actually not that much quicker. You can steam a carrot in like 5 or 6 minutes. That's all it takes. But then you've got to cut the thing up. It's just laziness, really. But they only had one left. I said, "Where's all the vegetables?" And she said, "Oh, well, they were part of the meal deal, so they all went." They had an entire cooler cabinet full up with these meal deal for two type things, Valentine's type meals, or they were all gone by 12:30. And of course, you can see, well, you know what blokes are, what real men are like myself, of course. Real men like myself are like, we leave it till the last minute, don't we? Even my nephew, Jimmy Butler, bought his little girlfriend a rose. Yeah, I thought that was a bit tight as well, but I'm going to have a word with him. Jimmy Butler, he only bought his girlfriend a rose. I said to my sister this morning, "Does he take her out anywhere?" My sister said to me, "Well, she goes to the football with him sometimes. That's about it." I'm going to have a word with my nephew. I don't think he's treating her very well at all. Dear, dear me. So yesterday. And then I had a little sleep in the afternoon, as always. Got up again. And as I said to you, I was hoping to watch that film last night, and I did. What's her name? Mrs. Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children. I watched that last night. Oh, what a lovely film. Highly, highly recommended. All right, boys and girls, if you want a lovely, warm film to watch, I would imagine a little bit scary for children. There's a couple of monsters in there. They're not too bad. That didn't scare me. Well, they would have done if they appeared at my front door, they would. But they're okay. There's a couple of monsters in there. But such a lovely, warm, charming film. English quintessential, I would say that is. And part of it's filmed in Wales. Or they say it's Wales. I don't know if it's actually Wales. Part of it's filmed in Wales and Florida. Florida is one of my favourite places in the world due to Disney. I quite like the way the massive roads like that they've got and little wooden houses that they all live in there. It's lovely. But I wouldn't mind retiring to somewhere like Florida. Is that possible? I don't know. But it's a lovely film and highly recommended. If you want to go and if you want to see that, you can get it on DVD. And it's on my mate's. We watched it on my mate's Sky thing. He's got Sky Q thing. We watched it on that and highly recommended. All right. So Mrs. Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children. And the film is about this home with children who have all got something strange. They can all do something strange. Like there's one girl and she looks also pretty. But her eating mouth is in the back and it's a great big mouth. And she lifts her hair up and shoves a carrot in the back of her head. There's another boy, of course, who's invisible. Let me think. Another one who can make inanimate things come to life, like skeletons and things like that. It's a really, really lovely film. Please watch it, okay? Mrs. Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children. Oh, what's her name's in it? Dame Judi Dench is in it. Not very much, though. She had a very, very small part. I don't know how much she got for that. Dear me. She was only in it for about 3 minutes. Yeah, not much from Dame Judi Dench, although, of course, as always, fantastic to see her in any form. In any sort of, whether it's just for the whole film or not, I love her. Dame Judi Dench, and I love also Maggie Smith. Two of my favourite actresses. They're wonderful, they are. I can't remember who it was or the lead role, what her name was. The girl who played Mrs. Peregrine. But she was very, very good as well. As was the American boy. And it had his father. I hated his father. You know, because the boy has got, you know what young people are like. They've got all imagination, I think is the word I'm looking for. Imagination and excitement in their life. And he only takes some old father or something like that, you know, to bring them down to level. And I always think that's very sad. I really do. It's a bit like, I've mentioned this before, you know, when you go to a football match and you've got all the fathers standing around the sides of the football pitch. And their little boys playing. And when I say little, I mean, you know, 8, 9, 10 years old. And, you know, some of them are not very good at it. It doesn't matter. And you hear these fathers screaming at their little boys. Oh, you're really useless, you are. Why don't you kick the effing ball and all this? They're talking to their own children, not someone else's. And I think that's awful. You know, if you're a parent, I think you need to pull up your children, whatever they are. If they're no good at something, doesn't matter, you don't tell them that, do you? Awful. Awful. You've got to be nice to your children and that's it. Let's say hello to some early people who are with us today. Let me just bring that up. One moment, please. We're trying to connect you, caller. Let me push that button. Actually, Gustav, I've got to tell you, as soon as I see your name come up now, you don't even need to tell me. Push the button. And I hadn't pushed it again. Thank you very much, Gustav. Hello to Adam. Good afternoon, Adam. Wendy's with us today. Kevin's with us today. Afternoon, Kevin. You look at, do you like my lemon shirt? I like this. I think this is one of my oldest shirts that I've got in there. Beautiful, bright yellow colour. We like bright colours. I keep telling you that. What I'd like to get next is I haven't got a grey jacket. And I haven't got a white, not quite white, maybe a creamy white colour jacket. They're the next two items on my clothing shopping list. Oh, actually, Ronnie might be able to get me one because he's going to New York in a couple of weeks. If he goes to one of the outlets there, although at $1.20 a pound, he's not going to get very much. I think that's going to be a bit of a shock to him. You know, because when I've gone to America, I think the lowest I've ever got is about $1.40. Something like that. Now it's $1.20. Why go away? I keep telling people that. Just go and get a caravan somewhere. You'd be much happier driving to a caravan somewhere. 2 hours. No passport control. No security. No nasty dinner on a plane. Although I've got to be honest, I've always enjoyed the food on planes. These people moan, don't they? There's nothing wrong with the food on planes. Gustav says, have you ever noticed Chris is always very dismissive of Aldi, but he knows what's inside? Of course I go to Aldi. You don't believe half of what I say, do you? Some people do, though. Now, you may remember yesterday, Gustav, I put a photo of a very large house and I was standing in front of it. I took a picture of it. And I said at the top of my Facebook. If you're not on my Facebook, you can have a look. It's Chris Reardon UK, my Facebook, okay? Facebook.com/ChrisReardonUK. And if you looked at it yesterday, that I'd done like a picture of myself. Okay, I'll use the youthful term, a selfie. I've done a selfie, but not with the lips, you know. Why do they do it, dear? Honestly, some people in the places I work while I'm doing, actually not the karaoke dudes, but if I'm DJing somewhere, these young people, they spend half of their night taking photos of themselves and uploading them. Who wants to watch it? Where is the entertainment in value in that? At least I'm talking crap to you. You know, there's nothing there. Like that all the time with the cameras, isn't they? So I took this picture in front of my house, in front of this great big house. It's actually, the house you saw in the picture is actually a place called South Hill Park. It's only a few minutes walk away from my house, and it is beautiful there. It's this great big old house, and what they've got in here is a theatre. South Hill Arts Centre is the correct title of the whole thing. And they have a theatre there, and they have lots of performances throughout the year of all different things. I haven't actually been in the theatre. I've just popped in there to use the toilet occasionally. And they have like a bar in the other side. Beautiful grounds with fountains in it, and you can eat outside, little benches and things like that. And there's a mini maze that they've got little hedgerows that they've created into a maze and planting and all that, which is all done, I think, by volunteers look after a lot of this stuff. And anyway, I said it was my house. And at the top of the thing, I said, one of my properties, you know, I am a landlord. That part of it is true. I am a landlord. When my mother and father died, I put my money into property and I've still got it all. So that's my thing. But of course, that wasn't one of my places. You know, I mean... How would you possibly think that that's my house? But you know, as I uploaded it and I was walking back to my house ready to do yesterday's show, actually, I thought to myself, you know, I bet some people on here are actually going to look at that house and think it's mine. You just know that's the case. Not only that, I actually got a private message from a lady inquiring that if the place is still available to let, and how much was it? Would it be because it was for her and some her children who were moving up here from another area? Now, this message came not from anyone I'm connected to on Facebook, as one of those message requests. You know, you get those sometimes. You get these message requests. Well, I do anyway, from people that you're not a friend with on Facebook, and you can read it. You can actually read these messages. And without anyone knowing, you've read it until you click a button, like an accept button. You have either accept or decline. If you click decline, they don't know whether you've read it or not. If you click accept, they know you've read it. But you can actually read it without clicking the accept. And she was asking me if the place was still available. I didn't want to let her down. You know, so I just replied that it had already gone. At which point she asked if I knew anywhere else, and I put her in contact with an estate agent. You know, but people actually believe some of the things. You must remember, a lot of the time when I'm talking to you, I'm sending myself up. It's a lot easier to take the mick out of yourself than it is anyone else. And then no one can be offended, can they? But people would take offence. I've had that before where I've said something about myself, maybe the fact that the gay thing. OK, you know, I've run something like I've said something, I don't know. Oh, you can definitely tell they're gay. And someone says, oh, you can't say that. That's really offensive. Why not? I'm gay. Yeah, but you can't say that. Well, I have. Go away. That's it. It's so much easier taking the mick out yourself than someone else, isn't it? So do remember that. You know, some of the stuff is of course true. And it's the clever people like you. It's the clever people that can sort out the truths from the white lies. And remember, if it is a white lie, it is always told to amuse you and for no other reason. All right. Let's do some of the other messages coming in today. Hello to Leon Corrigan. Hello, Leon. I hope you had a nice birthday the other day. Terry Turner's with us this afternoon. Hello, Terry. Currently watching you on a television with Anthony Taylor. Are you a Chris Ridden virgin, Anthony? Oh, there's more and more of you as the time goes, the years go on, unfortunately. But there weren't any in the 90s. There were no Chris Ridden virgins. I'd had them all. Oh, hello, Anthony. Welcome along, sir. Gavin Bass is there as well. Hello, Gavin. You're not cooking sausages again under that grill that you burnt last time I was there? That's about 20 years ago, isn't it? When was that time I went to visit you, Terry, at your little radio studio? And I can't remember who was there now. There was you, Gavin, some other bloke who was really annoying. Who was he? He really annoying, he was. And, yes, I can't remember who else was there. Because we were all doing radio then, weren't we? Yeah, we were all doing radio then. I kind of fell out of love with radio for some... and I don't know why. I think I progressed to the video thing. And as I've said many times, that was just a mistake. The getting into the doing the video things was a complete mistake. It was someone that suggested I put a camera in front of me one day. I'd already started doing the talk radio shows. I'd been doing that for a few years. And I put the camera in front of me. Oh, no, I don't know about this. And I did it. And then it just carried on. So that was a mistake. And then kind of the music radio fell into the background a bit. And I don't know, even if I was offered a job, I always aspired to being on Radio 2. I always aspired to being on Radio 2. But even if I was offered that now, do you know, I don't know if I'd like to do it or not anymore. Isn't that funny how things change, Terry? You, of course, are into radio in big time, aren't you? Is it West Anglia Radio or East Anglia Radio you're running now? Terry's had a number of little internet stations, which I have to say he runs very well. He really does. He's an excellent host for music radio, really are. Top marks to Terry, all the stuff. And I don't just say that, I absolutely mean that. You know, I think you're an excellent radio presenter, okay? As will be the lovely Elaine, who's with us this afternoon. Elaine's in Israel. Good afternoon, Elaine. I've managed to hear almost all of your excellent Barry Manilow special now, my darling. And Elaine has now been offered her own radio show on Israeli radio. Ba 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 ba. It's Elaine, da-da-da-da-da, Radio Israel International. That isn't an actual jingle from there. Just want to point that out. But I can't remember the name of a station. It's quite difficult to remember. And you can't read it because it's all like squiggles. There's no real... They don't have real letters in Israel. They're little squiggles. They're all in Hebrew. Very ancient language, Hebrew. How fantastic to be able to talk a little bit like that. Elaine, I can do a little bit of Latin. I can do a little bit of Latin, but religious Latin. I mean, I'll be honest, I don't really know what it means. I can recite various prayers in Latin, you know. Gloria in excelsis Deo, et ex patre tard nominibus, bonum voluntatis, lauda. Do you want me to carry on? It's about 3 minutes long. No, I didn't think you would. So good morning to Elaine. Good afternoon to Elaine. Hello to Matthew. Hello, Matthew. Phone lines are opening shortly, Matty. And then when the phone line opens, if you're watching the live show, a number will appear in the top left-hand corner. How exciting is that, Matt? It really is. I just want to do the messages first, because what I'm finding has happened, I get onto a call and then we go so far back with the messages and I can only go back so far. So that's why I haven't done the phone number yet. All right, Matty, stand by. Matty Joplin, who's a lovely chap looking for DJ and work. He works in Asda at the moment, don't you? Hello to Tweety Charla, who said the books are even better. There are three so far. I love the Miss Peregrine stories. Yes, Tweety. Talking about that excellent film that I saw last, and I've been wanting to watch that for months, and I was not disappointed. One of the best films I've seen for ages. I watched last night, if you're just joining us, Miss Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children, and it got to the end. And when it got to the end, Tweety, I did think to myself, that's been left so that you can have more. Do you know what I mean? So presumably on the next film, we're going to another loop. Because Mrs. Peregrine and her children are in like a time loop, of a 24-hour time loop, and it keeps coming round. And something happens, something bad happened to that time loop, so they had to leave that time loop and travel to another one in Blackpool, if I remember. So they're now in another time loop, and it's been left so you can have more of those. So I do hope there is... Actually, would there be another one? Let's have a look. Will there be another... Miss Peregrine film. Let's ask our good friend Google. One moment, please. Blah, blah, blah. Right, this is on Movie Pilot. Miss Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children 2. Will there be a sequel? Does it say? No, it doesn't say. Would there be a sequel? No. I mean, there are books. The second book, I think, is called Hollow City, according to this. It might happen. It says it might happen. So there's nothing... No, there's nothing guaranteed yet. So hopefully we will have a second film there. And I shall certainly watch that as well. All right. Hello to Joey. Good afternoon, Joey. Hello to lovely Pamela. Good morning, Pamela. Pamela's with us today. We're twiddling knobs. Good afternoon to Tim Partington. Tim, it's about time you came down to one of my quiz nights, dear. It's quiz night tonight. If you're around in North London in Islington, I'm hosting karaoke a quiz night at the King's Head Theatre Bar, Upper Street in Islington. It starts at 8:30. Get there about 8 o'clock. All right, Madonnas. Ray Reynolds is with us again this afternoon. Hello again from the George Formby Society. And Ray Reynolds and Tim Partington says, I think you get those Israeli hieroglyphics on the top of virtually every chicken takeaway. Oh, they love the chicken soup. They love chicken soup. In Israel. Those lovely Jewish ladies, if you're ill, you're straight round to their house for some chicken soup, aren't you? Mmm. Although I'm vegetarian, we can't be eating dead chickens, thank you. Good afternoon to William. It's a lovely summer evening in Sydney. My friend's over there at the moment, William. You've seen her on the karaoke streams. Mary, non-Irish Mary from Ireland, is in Sydney at the moment. She was telling me, not yesterday, I think the day before, 38 degrees. Oof. No, too hot for me, I'm afraid. 38 degrees. Good afternoon, Daniel Rolfe. Good afternoon, Daniel. I was down in Camberley a couple of days ago at Tesco's. Now, we went there for something. Oh, the cat food was on special offer in Tesco's yesterday. What was it? No, it might have been the end of last week. Went to Tesco's. I can't remember now. Tesco's, yes. Terry says, you came down to the barbecue about 15 years ago. 15 years? Gosh. Also, Anthony thinks you are in your early 40s. Oh, Anthony, I'm not going to lie to you. I'm 54. There's too many people lying about their age all the time, which is just pathetic. It really is. Anthony, I am 54, darling, OK? Gavin thinks you should do a cooking spot like you did for a while years ago. Yeah, we did, didn't we? We did a couple of cookery shows, didn't we, in the kitchen. Would you like me to show you how to make a very, very difficult item to make? Angel Delight. Yum, yum, yum. For the first time yesterday, I made my mate Angel Delight. And instead of having the whole packet, because it does say serves four, and I have been eating the whole one. We had half each. So I make it in a little mixing bowl type thing. You put your milk in, you know, about, I think it's about a third of a pint, half a, no, it's not half, is it? About a third of a, quarter of a pint, third of a pint of milk. Put that in, put the powder in and whisk it up. Lovely Angel Delight. Mmm. But don't make it with soya milk. It doesn't work. What you end up is a very delicious strawberry milkshake, but it doesn't go stiff. Right. Tim says, I had a celebrity on the karaoke night. Denise from Tight Fit. Oh, yes. In the jungle, the mighty jungle. And I'll tell you who I know from Tight Fit, actually. Steve. I have worked with that group three or four times, actually, over the years. They're lovely. They're so nice. And Steve, who's the lead singer, of course, is in his early 60s. And he is built like a brick house. He really is. He's bought like a brick house. He's all muscles, isn't he? He's always down the gym, Steve. Lovely man he is. Adam says, think of the sins. Yeah, but I only had half of it, Adam. I only had half of it, OK? Right, let's open the phone lines, boys and girls. The number has now appeared on your screen. Look at that. You love those graphics, don't you? Call in if you want to at any point. 020-8144-3477 is the phone number, OK? 020-8144-3477. If you want to Skype in as well, we have a Skype in number. The Skype in is, or a Skype in name, all one word, United Kingdom Talk, OK? The Skype is United Kingdom Talk. They're the way to contact the show this afternoon. Either 020-8144-3477, the phone-in number, or Skype in on United Kingdom Talk. Operators are standing by. If you don't want to call in and you just want to listen or watch instead, that's all right as well. We want to go back to the messages from yesterday's show. Now, I like to do that now at the beginning of the show because often I get so far into it and then I forget. Because nothing's written. Well, I mean, you know, I've got a few one-liners. Nothing is set out. Nothing is set in stone. There's none of this timed business, you know. And William, I know what I'm talking about. This, you know. News. 0002. Jingle. 0002.15. Talk for 15. No, there's none of that here, dear. We just switch on and chat away. That's how we like it. Rachel was very, very disappointed that she wasn't with the live show yesterday. Rachel, you need to keep waking up, dear. Have you got your Have you subscribed to the show? Because if you're on a mobile, I don't think it works with computers, I'm not sure. But if you're on a mobile device, you should see a little subscribe button somewhere on there. Wendy sent me a little picture of one there the other day, actually. Just hit the subscribe button, and then whenever a show comes on, as long as you've got the notification setting thing switched on, you'll get a little flash, or I will vibrate you. I will vibrate you violently. I really will vibrate wherever your phone is placed. Okay, which means a show has started, and then you'll get the 5 minute countdown, and it starts like that, so you won't miss it then. All right, Joanna, who is still in hospital, says my favourite love song. We were talking about love songs yesterday. What is your favourite love song? And her favourite love song is Unchained Melody. Oh God, I can't stand that one, Joanna. My love, my darling. Oh, there's a bloke who used to sing that at karaoke. His name will not be iterated from my mouth. Claude. His name was Claude, and he used to sing that one. Oh, he couldn't hit the high notes. My love. And he used to blame the microphone. On my life, he used to blame the microphone. He was coming to the do's for years. And whenever I saw Claude, I thought, oh, no, not him again. And there's not many people I'll say this about. But he constantly moaned. He was always moaning. Much to the point where, of course, you can't say it. You can't say it to someone because it's not your pub. You know, you want to say to these people, please don't come anymore because you upset me. Yeah, he would come in with this list of songs and the list would never change. He'd have the same songs and the same order, and he'd give you the list, 1, 2, 3, 4. And then after he sung a song, he'd wait a while and come back again. Oh, what is my next song? Well, you gave me the bit of paper, don't you know? Oh, can I change the position of the songs? Oh, on and on. And then if he was, you know, if it's a busy night, then you're going to wait, aren't you, between songs? And he'd be up everywhere. Is it my turn again? No, it's not you. You've got another half hour yet. But I've been waiting an hour. Well, so there's an hour's worth of singers in front of you. That's how it is. Moan and moan and moan. And I don't see him anymore because I do. I've changed the places I work at. And he doesn't come to the other ones. Good. Kiki D rung in. Kiki D sent a message as well and says her favourite song is I Can See Clearly Now. Now, what is that one? I can see clearly now the rain has gone. Ba-da-da-da-da-da. Now, that one's quite nice. Who sung that one, I Can See Clearly Now? Anyone remember? Tim will tell us. Tim will tell us. Tim, you know who I mean, don't you, Claude? What a miserable bastard that is. I'm sorry. He sits in the corner all and looks miserable as sin, and he watches. He watches. And if you make a mistake and accidentally put someone in front of him who's already been up once, then he's straight over. Oh, that's not very fair. Oh, moan and moan and moan. And you don't want these people to turn up. You actually don't. Well, you end up hating them. You do. I'm sorry you do. He probably hates me as well. Good. Don't come. Gavin says, hello, Gavin, who says, hi, Chris, hope you're well. I'm at Terry's, got you on his TV, looks good. Can you say hello to me, Terry, and Ant? Ant. Me, Terry, and Ant. I quite like that. Anthony is shortened to Ant. Ant, very nice. I had, now have I still got it here? For my birthday, is it still here? Oh, it might not be here. It might have moved downstairs now to some other place. Let's see, is it here? No, it's not here now. Oh, hang on, what's that? No, that's not it. One minute. But. No, it's not here. I had, for my birthday, an ant named after me. It might have been Wendy, actually. Someone sent me a card and an ant has been named after me. How fantastic is that? Not you, obviously, Ant. You're Ant Anthony, aren't you? You're not Ant. You're Ant Anthony. Yes. Ray Reynolds says, Johnny Nash... Ah, thank you very much. Johnny Nash did that one. I can see clearly now the rain has gone. Ba-da-ba-ba-ba-ba. They should do a dance version of that, Ray. I think you should sing that one. It's time for you to sing a few new songs, Ray. Although, my favourite song that Ray Reynolds does is Flash Bang Wallop, you know? Da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Bang. Ba-da-da. Banging on a big bass drum. What a whimper. Da 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 dum diddy dum 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 dum. Sticking in your family album, that one. That's my favourite song that Ray Reynolds does. True. Wendy says, yes, the ant named after you is in your... Oh, it's in my book. Thank you, Wendy. Which is in the toilet. Would you like to see it? Just a moment. Talk amongst yourself. Is anyone going to call in? 020-8144-3477 is the phone number. Let me just get my book. One minute. What a picture, what a picture. Stick it in your family album. Oh, it's lovely. Lovely to be in the studio with the toilet close by. It really is. You know, let me see if I can find this. This is the book that Wendy bought me for my birthday, which sits in the toilet, in the little boys' room. For those days when you're in there, perhaps a little bit longer, when it won't flow quite so easily, I have to give it a little bit of a push and a shove. Now, let me see. Where's the ant that's been named after me? It's here somewhere. Here it is. Here it is. Now, Chris the Ant. Check this out. Look, an ant has been that one there. Can you see? To mark the historic occasion for your birthday, Wendy Young has taken the liberty of naming an ant in your honour at the Book of Everyone Ant Farm. You can catch all the antics of Chris the Ant online with our webcam at www.thebookofeveryone.com/antfarm. Have a look yourselves if you want. Or at the Book of Ants on Twitter. So that is the ant that has been named. That is Chris the Ant. Chris the Ant. Look how busy I am. Working hard. Working hard, working 9 to 5. No, thank you. Oh, 9 to 5 jobs in an office. Oh, how boring are they? They sit tap, tap, tapping away on their keyboards all day. Tap, tap, tap on the keyboards. Oh, it must have been much more fun on a typewriter. Don't you think? At least they made a little bit of noise. What characters typewriters have, don't you think? In fact, when I finish a show today, just drop down to the post underneath it, I think it is, and you will see an orchestra, I think it's the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra, playing the typewriter song. And it looks like it's in the Royal Albert Hall or somewhere like that. Massive big stage, a whole orchestra on there, and a bloke comes on with a typewriter. And it is hilarious and excellent, excellent piece of music, the typewriter song, which was also for years and years played out by one of the drag queens that I worked with a couple of times, Regina Fong, the great Regina Fong, who's been gone a few years now. And she used to do the typewriter song. Well, on this video that is on my wall now, you'll see the orchestra there. Bloke walks on with a typewriter. And it's all like that. So watch that later. There we are. See how I'm linking in, professionally linking into other stories today? Oh, I'm so clever. Wendy says, it's true about the ant farm. I haven't looked online at it yet, actually, Wendy. I must look and see how Chris the Ant is doing at the moment. Yes. Thank you, Tim, for the link there. That's probably the song, is it? Stick It in the Family. What a picture. Flashbang Wallop. I think that's probably the link to Flashbang Wallop you've put up there. Tim also says, Global Scouse Day is happening on the 28th of February. Oh, is it really? Let's have a little look at that. Chefs across the UK are being urged to participate in the 5th annual Global Scouse Day this February. Global Scouse Day 2017 takes place on February 28th with restaurants, cafes and pubs putting this traditional dish at the forefront of their menu in a celebration of Liverpool culture. Well, what's the dish? What is the dish? Global Scouse Day? Well, what is the dish? Last year, venues far and wide showed appreciation for Liverpool's finest culinary export as GSD, Global Scouse Day, was celebrated in New York, Washington and other places. Well, gets bigger and bigger with over 150 restaurants putting scouse on their menu. What is that, scouse? I don't even know what that is, Tim. Whether you make it with beef or... Oh, OK, let's look it up. What is scouse? What is scouse? Isn't this Google thing? You know, years ago, I would have had to have an entire shelf of Encyclopedia Britannica behind me, wouldn't it? Actually, there's nothing. Isn't that nice when you see someone's shelves full of these beautiful books? Now you just type it in. Scouse, the dialect of accent of people from Liverpool. Oh, food. Here we go. Here it is. Look. Ah, Scouse is a type of lamb or beef stew. The word comes from lobscouse, a stew commonly eaten by sailors throughout Northern Europe. Oh, so it's actually a meal. I thought it was just an accent. So you learn a new thing every day here on the United Kingdom Talk. You can't afford not to miss a show. No. Ah, so it's a meal. Thank you, Tim. Well, we know what that is now, don't we? Thank you. Scouse food, yes. Stacey's with us this afternoon. Good afternoon to you, Stacey. Don't forget you can call in. 020-8144-3477 is the phone number this afternoon, as always, gang. Or you can just sit there and watch. That's okay as well. I don't mind. Doesn't bother me if people don't love me enough to call in. I understand that. It's been such a long time. You know, I'm not really loved at all. I've got some lovely stories for you as well. Was watching the television this morning and also talking to Ray Reynolds about this on the phone on a private call. Some people have my private phone number. Ray Reynolds has my private phone number. And it was on the Victoria Derbyshire programme. That's at 9 o'clock on BBC News 24. She's the posh one. Although she wasn't on it this morning. It was someone else. Can't remember her name now. But she's just as good. Very nice girl on there. And they had two people there that were kind of struggling with their money, as I'm sure many of you are as well. One of them was this boy who just seemed to just come out of university. And he was saying, the trouble with university, you know, go through all this time learning stuff and what have you, thinking you're going to get a really good job at the end of it. Now, the whole universities thing is in the grand scheme of things, quite a recent thing. I think there's probably more, I think more young people now go than don't. You have to correct me if I'm wrong there. I don't know the figures. But that's how it seems to me. Whenever I see young people now, oh, yeah, yeah, you're going to university. Very few of them have not been to university. Now, this is a complete about turn, because when I was a child, hardly anyone went to university. When I've said before, I can't think of anything more boring. You know, I couldn't wait to get out of school. I went to a very good school. I liked my school. But once it was finished, I can't think of anything worse than having to go back to school again and listen to these old people chatting away, trying to teach me things that I wasn't very good at learning anyway. And it was Blair, wasn't it? It was Tony Blair that tried to push everyone into university. But I don't go along with it at all. There's so many people that have been to university and end up at the other end in McDonald's. Now, there's not necessarily anything wrong with working in McDonald's. Some people want to work in McDonald's. They want to start down there tossing the burgers, and they want to finish running their own restaurant. They want to work up. I understand that. If you want to do that, that's great. It's a good job. It's a good job if you want to work out. But there are people working at McDonald's who didn't want to work there. They wanted to be city people, work in banks, be solicitors or anything like that. But they can't get jobs. So they end up working in McDonald's or places like that. You understand what I mean by that. As I say, nothing wrong. If you want to work in McDonald's, that's great. But if you don't and you are working there, that's not good. And I do not believe that there are jobs for everyone that goes to university. I think you are wasting a lot of time. Not only that, so this boy's on there. And I suppose it's difficult to tell his age, actually. Probably about 22, 23, I would guess. And he had glasses on. And he was saying, the trouble is, it comes to the end of university and you've got no money because you've had all these loans, which, again, Tony Blair brought in. There were no charges for going to university, were there, before old Blair came in. He was saying, you get to the end of it, and then you think, right, you're going to get a very good job now. The trouble is, a lot of them don't get a very good job. They get a job, but not necessarily that good. And then he was saying, a few days after leaving university, and you get this letter through your letterbox telling you that you now owe £40,000. £40,000. I mean, I cannot imagine me leaving school when I left school. And then a few days later, a bill would drop through the door for £40,000. This, you know, it's not just him. It's all of them. They all get suddenly this great big bill comes through, which, of course, doesn't have to be paid for until you're earning a certain amount of money and all that business. But can you just imagine getting that bill through the door? Adam the plumber's on the line. Hello, Adam.
Good afternoon, Chris Fridden.
Afternoon, sir. How are you today? All right?
I'm very good, thank you. I've just thought of a subject that you can ask your callers to call in about.
Yes.
Today, I don't know if you realise, it's National Be Nice Day, or Acts of Random Kindness.
Oh, is it really?
Yes. If you Google acts that of, one. It's
acts of random, random Kindness.
That's the one, yes.
Did you go to university?
No, I didn't. No, I didn't even finish school.
All right, you naughty boy. Did you not get into the fifth? What, fifth? When did you leave?
I left when I was 11 years old.
Blimey, that's early.
Yeah, the reason is, as you probably know, Chris, because you've known me a long time, I suffer with hyperactive disorder. And as a child, I was very, very disruptive in school. They called it ADHD, I think they call it.
How old are you again, Adam?
I'm 44. I'm 45 in May.
Ah, so they stopped caning and hitting people by the time you was at school, didn't they?
No. Oh, no, you still had the slipper.
Well, you need. Well, you obviously didn't have it enough, Adam.
No, I didn't.
What you need is a good slap round your face. That is exactly what you needed when you was a child, dear. None of this. This is why they're all going to pot now. No one's hitting them.
Mm, this is true.
Go on.
So I ended up being pulled out of school because I was doing naughty things like jumping up on the school roof and things like that. And I was tutored one to one from the age of 11.
Oh my word!
So when it came to my 16th birthday, I said, "Thanks very much. I haven't learned anything. Goodbye."
Yeah. Let me ask. At what age did you have your first job? Not necessarily first big job. Your very, very first job. What age were you?
I know exactly my very first. Well, my first official job was working for Pizza Hut as a delivery boy.
Right. How old were you then?
When I was 16.
16. Okay. Yeah.
Yep. Yeah, just turned 16. Got my motorbike license, and the first thing I done was went down to the local pizza shop and said, "Haven't got any delivery driver jobs. I've got a license. Can
you
I
wanted
work
your
for
own
you?"
money, didn't you?
Yeah, I did. I wanted money. I had accrued some money before that with Saturday jobs, working in cafes and greengrocers and butcher shops. I'd worked in those doing Saturday jobs, and I managed to accrue about, I suppose by today's standards, it would be about £6,000.
Right.
From the age of 14. I think I told you before.
I'm losing you again. What did you say then?
Hang on a second. Let me put you on loudspeaker so that improves it. Say yeah. How's that, Chris? Is that better?
Much better. When we finish the show, if you can pick this up, about 43 minutes.
Yeah,
go,
I will do.
Go to 42 minutes and go to 41 minutes and listen to your own call, and then you'll see what the problem is. All right.
Sure.
My hands haven't moved. It's not your fault. It's the iPhone 7. My mate, I was talking to my mate again today, and I said, "You've moved the phone," and he screams down the phone, and he said, "I haven't moved the phone. It's your hearing." But you will see. You'll see what I mean. Anyway, carry on, mate.
I think it's actually not so much the seven. It's the plus ones, the 7 plus.
Yes, he's got a plus.
Yeah, it's not. It's not the 7. It's the plus.
Oh, right.
It's
okay.
A big phone. So yeah, I started off when I was young, selling birdseed down Trafalgar Square when I was about 13.
Yeah,
that was my first thing that I'd done. And then I fell off of Nelson's column.
From the top?
No, just from the plinth level. I slipped on some pigeon mess and broke my nose. So if you look at my picture carefully there, you can see I've got a broken nose.
Yeah, it does look a bit big in that picture, yeah. I didn't like to say anything, dear. I'm not going around calling you, what's his name? Not Noddy. What's his name? The one with the nose that grows.
I don't know now.
Oh. what's his name?
Big nose, hold on.
Big nose. No, what's the... Pinocchio. I'm not going to call you Pinocchio. I'm not, love.
No, don't.
I'm not.
No.
Because you'll be offended, won't you? Go on, tell me you're offended. Say it.
I'm offended, Chris.
Good,
offended.
Good. Be offended, then. Be offended. We don't care.
I'm really offended by your remarks, and I'm never going to watch your show ever again.
Go on, carry on. We want to hear more about the time you fell off of going on the bird dirt.
Yeah, so I fell off there and broke my nose, and was sitting there in rather a lot of pain, and unfortunately was picked up by this guy who wanted to pretend to be my uncle, but I saw through that. And...
Call me daddy. You say, yes, daddy, yes, daddy.
Yeah, so I think he wanted to do naughty things to me. But
someone trying to
fit
with some dirty old bastard. I hope you told him where to go.
Did you just take the money? Actually, I was in so much pain at the time. He took me to the hospital. And then when the hospital got a bit suspicious, they phoned my mum. And my mum said, hasn't got an uncle, sort of thing. You know, his uncle's here with me now. Who the hell is it, sort of thing. And they called the police and he'd done a runner.
Did you get the money first?
And that's the last time I ever saw Ray Reynolds. Oh. I'm joking, Ray, I'm joking. Don't
I
be offended.
I told you,
Ray,
get the money first. Oh, my word. Can you just imagine coming out of university with a bill for £40,000?
I know. Well, Sean's actually an A&E nurse, and he had a horrendous bill after doing his nursing, nursing degree and what have you.
How old is he?
He's now 34.
So what happens? How does this work? So you leave university and literally does a letter just come through the door telling you how much you owe?
I believe that's the way it works, yeah. Which, I don't believe in it, especially for nurses and doctors. I mean, they should be allowed to train for free. You know, the service they provide, they should be allowed to train for free. They really should.
I agree. Unless they're trained by the NHS, and the moment they get their training, a lot of them leave to go to the private jobs, don't they? This is a problem.
I think there should be a minimum. If they are going to stay with the NHS, you know, there should be a minimum year, maybe five years before they can transfer into, you know, private jobs or whatever.
Yes. Yeah.
That's the way I think it should be done.
Yeah. Wendy's agreeing with that remark as well, Adam.
Yeah, I just saw that come up on the screen there.
All right. Well, thanks for calling in, sir.
No problem, Chris. And remember, it is National Be Kind Day, so be kind to somebody and do something generous. I'll just tell you one very quick one, if I may, before I go.
Yes, yes.
Basically, my boss at the company I work for just recently donated a transit van to UK Homes for Heroes, the charity that support the homeless soldiers on the streets of the UK. And he gave it to them totally free of charge. The van was probably, he could have probably sold the van for £3,000-£4,000, but he gave it to them totally free of charge. So that was his random act of kindness.
An act of kindness. Thank you, Adam. Yeah. That's lovely, yes, isn't it? What's his name?
His name, James McHugh.
Name of the company?
B&M McHugh.
There you go. They donated a van. Thank you, Adam.
Cheers now.
Cheers now. Bye. Adam the plumber calling in for your boys and girls. That's who you want fixing your stuff at home if you ever got something going wrong. Okay, Adam the plumber. He won't rip you off. But that is nice. Wendy says, a random act of kindness by me is doing these shows. Oh, I don't know if you could include that, Wendy, because I enjoy doing them as well, you see. A random act of kindness, I would imagine, is something that you wouldn't necessarily enjoy doing. I might do a random act of kindness to an elderly person tonight and let them win at the quiz. Obviously, I will not mention the name of this person. That could be my random act of kindness tonight at the quiz night this evening. Keith says, can I Skype in? Feel free, Keith. Lines are open. United Kingdom Talk is the Skype, okay? Alan says, that was very nice of your boss, Adam. Oh, absolutely, it was. It was. Ray Reynolds says, I'm not your uncle, Adam. I'm offended. Oh, they're all offended. Everyone's offended all the time, aren't they? They really are. Thank you, Alan and Wendy. Say Pinocchio. That's right. That's who it was. Keefer's got an iPhone 7 Plus as well. There's a lot of problems hearing people with a 7 Plus. Suddenly you move the phone slightly from your mouth and you just disappear into the ether. You really do. Ray says, Flashbang Wallop is the film from Half a Sixpence. Thank you, Half a Sixpence. Now, first time I ever saw that film, it was a Christmas Eve. I always remember. I think I was 15 or 16 years old. Actually, Ray, it might be worth you checking the Christmas Eve television schedules for 1978 and 1979, 1980 and 1981. Check the Christmas Eve BBC schedules for that. I'm not sure which side it was on. I'm sure Half a Sixpence was on one of those occasions. Yes. And I watched it. I watched it just before I went to midnight mass. I would never forget that day. I was ever so tired. You know, I'd had a little sleep and I come downstairs and my mum says, oh, you don't have to come to church if you don't want to. And I wanted to. I wanted to come to midnight mass and I did. That was at St. Joseph's Catholic Church in Roehampton. Hello to Maori, who says, Chris, I can't keep up with you. You pop up at the most unexpected times. Ah, now this is the beauty of doing. Keith, are you going to call in? You can call in, Keith, United Kingdom Talk on the Skype if you want to. OK. The thing is with doing a none of these shows are scheduled, as you well know. They just appear. If you've got the subscribe, you need to hit the subscribe thing and you'll get a little message whenever there's one going on your iPhone or your non-iPhone phone. Yeah, something like that. You should get a little message whenever we're doing one or indeed on the computer. Now, the thing is, scheduled shows, yeah, I see it's probably the best thing to do is a scheduled show. 11 o'clock every day would be great. However, doing non-scheduled shows at random times, you get different people watching and listening. You get regular people all the time who are always there, but you don't get... you get other people. Some people can't watch in the morning. Some people can't watch in the afternoon. Some people can't watch at night. Some people can't watch late night. But other times they're there. So it's you kind of get different people watching all the time. So it's quite good to be able to do that sort of thing. All right, let's try and get Keith. No, I can't Skype you, Keith. You need to Skype me. Why can't you Skype in? It's easy. Do it. Just Skype in, Keith. United Kingdom Talk is the name, OK? It's incoming only. All right. United Kingdom Talk, if you want to call in there. All right. I did have a couple of news stories to do today as well. Oh, yes. We're talking about that. So that university boy on there, he owed £40,000. And it's so much. And he says, well, I haven't got a good job after it. I'm not sure he had a job. I didn't see the whole show. But he didn't have a good job. Now, I do know that you don't have to start paying back that money until you go over a certain amount. So you've got to hit a certain level before they start taking money off you. But nevertheless, you've got £40,000 to pay back. You can buy a caravan for 20, a brand new caravan for 22, 23. You know, it's terrible how much you own. Vectis says, I can't watch a show at night. It sends me to sleep. Well, there you go. You must be calling the wrong one, Keith. You're calling the right one, United Kingdom Talk. All one word, United Kingdom Talk. There's nothing flashing up here that says you've got a missed call. Nothing flashing up here. Has anyone else got Skype? Could you try it? Keith, I don't think Keith's Skype is working. If you're calling the Chris Ridden one, that doesn't exist anymore. It's the Skype name is United Kingdom Talk, Keith, all right? Try that one. Has anyone else got Skype that they could try for me? Anyone else around? Let's have a look. I don't know if any of you have got Skype 3D. Alex, has Alex got it? Ben, who's with us this afternoon who's got Skype? Let's have a look. Oh, Joey. Joey, you've got Skype. Can you try and call me, Joey? If you can try and call us and see if that works. Yes. Strange. I don't know why that's not working. Anyone else got a Skype they can try out? As well as that boy on there, there was another lady on there and she was doing two jobs. And she said she just couldn't make ends meet for some reason. She had two jobs and she said she lived once in Whitechapel and from there she had to move out to... Oh, God, where was it now? Somewhere in East London. Oh, big bus station. Can't remember what it's called now. Not Shoreditch. Anyway, she's had to move from Whitechapel out a bit. Now she's got to move out even further because she can't afford to live there. And she pays £1,000 per month for a one room ensuite. So she's got a bedroom, kitchen, living room, bathroom, all one room. There we go. Hello, is that you, Jerry? Hello? Jerry?
Hello.
Hello, Jerry. Yes? You calling on Skype, yeah? Jerry?
Yes, hello?
You're calling in on Skype, aren't you?
Yes, I am, yeah.
You haven't phoned in, have you? Your Skype, yeah?
No, Skype, yeah.
So that's working. Yeah, it must be something to do with your end, Keith. I don't know why you can't get us. All right, thanks, Jerry.
Okay.
Thank you, much appreciated. Yeah, well, that's tested the system. Yeah, it's your end. Must be your end. Yeah, Jerry's got through, all right? And we've had a phone call, and we've had a Skype in. So, sorry, Keith, can't help you. I don't know why that's not working, mate. All right? So this lady's now got to move out. £1,000 a week she's paying for a room with an ensuite. So she's got her own toilet, I suppose, and bathroom in it. £1,000 a week? A month? It's just impossible. And one of the things that the government say is because we haven't got enough houses. Now, you know, it's in such a state now that it's going to take us years to get out of it. And this is what I was talking to Ray Reynolds on the phone earlier today, that why don't we have caravans? You can buy, if I was to go out and buy a caravan, okay, it would cost me a brand new basic caravan. And when you buy a caravan, right, you've got your caravan, generally it comes with all the curtains, all the seating, the oven, the cooker, the fridge, the freezer. It's all built in. Brand new caravan, okay? You can get a second-hand one for about 5,000. Less than that, even. Now, that's just me. If I was to buy a new caravan, 23 grand, brand new, everything in there. If I was the government buying it, you know, you go to a company and say, right, well, we want 10,000 of those. What can you do those for? What's about probably about 14,000? You could make such a dent with the homeless problem by putting those things up. Not only that, there was an article the other day on the... Oh, it doesn't say what date on there. 1 minute. Oh, gosh, where's that gone now? There it is. It was in the Sun. It was in the Sun a couple of days ago. Lego house. Stackable Lego homes are being rushed out in an attempt to deal with the UK's housing crisis. Now, what I'll do is I'll put this on my Facebook, okay? And you can have a look at the picture on this. I've minimised the show, so you've still got the sound coming out, okay? So have a look at the top of my Facebook wall there. It's just coming up now. There it is. There's a picture of these little green houses. Now, from the outside of it, it looks like one of those porter cabins. Okay? Does look like a porter cabin. But once you're inside, different thing altogether. It says, designed to provide accommodation for those in urgent housing need. Chelmsford City Council in Essex, so they're already doing this, is hoping to build them after demolishing old garages. With the smallest measuring a minuscule 3.7 by 8.3 metres deep, the flats will soon be full of people needing a council flat. The plan comes just 3 months after a national report by a think tank revealing 1.2 million people are languishing on housing waiting lists in England. And when you have a look at that, yeah, it doesn't look anything from the outside. It just looked like a green box. But as I say, once you're in there, I'm sure there are some of you who live in flats. And on the outside, you might think, what a dump this is. But once you close that door, you create your own little palace in there, don't you? There's some flats down the road from me. Years ago, I went to look at one to buy. I didn't buy it. The outside of it was, I mean, bit of a dump. But you close that front door and you can make your little house an absolute palace. You can. Rents are expected to be low for the temporary homes in the affluent town, where a one-bedroom flat can go for as much as £1,100 a month. Last year, the council revealed the number of people expected to lose their homes is set to double in Chelmsford. So I'm looking at this and I'm thinking that's quite nice. They've got little bathrooms in it, proper bathrooms. You know, proper bathrooms. There's little kitchens in there. It's all in there. You've got your washing machine, fridge, freezer, all that stuff. Worktops, kitchen worktops in there. How much are these costing anyway? Let's have a look. I think about £35,000, aren't they? Something like that. It doesn't say. It doesn't say how much it is. Let's have a look. How much is it costing the council? That's just the rent there. The leader of Chelmsford City Council said, "We've looked at the way other authorities in the UK are addressing homelessness and the method appears to be effective in some areas. Many of these designs look like little houses," and they absolutely do. They're very good. Across two sites, there will be a total of 18 of the green painted temporary units. A single and double bedroom version will be used, with all featuring a shower room, kitchen and a living space. So you haven't got a bath. I mean, I haven't got a bath in here. I got rid of that ages ago. I don't like the idea of, you know, laying in dirty water for ages. The Essex plan comes after the YMCA in northeast London actually used shipping containers to help the homeless. And, you know, these homes in London are called MY pads, renting out £75 a week and feature flat screen TVs, ensuite bathrooms and air conditioning. And you know what? You know what? If you get a couple of bits of wood, shove them together with a good, decent bit of insulation in the middle, it's probably warmer than this house is, or at least, you know, costs a lot less to heat. I've always noticed whenever I've been on holiday in a caravan, and I always go for the ones with the central heating, they've got radiators in every room. It doesn't say anything. I didn't see anything about heating. They've bound to get heating in there. Bound to have heating in those places, haven't they? But these caravans, and you flick this button, well, 10 minutes, you're roasting in these places. And I'm looking at the picture of this, and I would live in one of those. I'd have no problem at all living in one of those. I think it's a good idea. What do you think? Do you think, would you live in one of those? Or do you think it's disgusting and that people shouldn't have to live in some... But if there's nowhere else, why not? I'd happily live in one of those or a caravan. I really would. Mobile home. Something like that. I've no problem with that. And surely the government could, at a stroke, reduce the homeless problem that we've got in this country just by sticking up some of these. And I guarantee you, some people who will be moving in now on a temporary basis won't want to leave. I bet they won't. What do you think? You can call in if you want to. 020 8144 3477. 020 8144 3477. Or you can Skype in. Our Skype in number is all one word, United Kingdom Talk. Okay, Skype in, United Kingdom Talk, or call in. Tell me what you think about that. 020 8144 3477. Keith, can I WhatsApp? No, there is no WhatsApp on the computer, mate. You can't WhatsApp in, I'm afraid. That's not available. Vector says, waiting for my tip truck on the very wet Isle of Wight. Is it raining there? We haven't got any rain here today. It's a bit dreary and misty, to be honest. It's been cloudy most of the morning when I walked up to the swimming pool. Mari says, Lego houses will become the modern day slums in years to come. Do you think so, Mari? Yeah, but I mean, those Lego houses to me, if you go to Florida, OK, go to Florida and all the houses are wooden there. I mean, they're not much different. OK, they're a bit more square and much smaller. But have a look at the houses in Florida when you see the films. They're all like wooden things with a little roof. Australia as well. My cousin had a very, very similar thing to this. And you look at these places and you just know they don't cost much to put up. Cost a lot to put a house up. Bricks and all that. But these are just basically little wooden things like that, aren't they? So there we are. Elaine says, I've got a new name for my show starting on Sunday. It's called Elaine's Lounge or Lane's Lounge. Oh, well, I quite like that, Elaine. What time are you on Sunday then? We'll all have to try and listen to that, OK? Don't be afraid. We'll all try and listen to Elaine's show on Sunday. That's a good idea, that will. Wendy says Lego houses wouldn't become the slums to come if people respect them. And I think people would. I think they would. Handmade shacks, Keith says. Yeah. Handmade shacks. Keith says over in Tenerife, the poverty here is terrible. People are living in... Oh, hang on. You talking about here or where you live, Keith? I know there are certain people living here in sheds. I mean, this is certainly one up from a shed, isn't it? I know there's people in places like Ealing and Hounslow in particular who have converted sheds in their garden. Wendy says, I think it's a great idea. I'd live in one of those. Yeah, I would. They got windows. They're just like little houses. Wendy also says, I could live in a caravan quite easily. My dad had one, as you know. I love it. Oh, I'm hoping to get a caravan, Wendy. I'm really hoping to get a caravan maybe next year. I've kind of got some little targets. Not targets, you know, have you got like bits in your life that you want to get to? And caravan owner is one of them. And it would be near my sister. It would be near my sister. That would be my own little house. I have got a place up there, but I quite like a caravan, yeah. Mary says, a bit like prefabs after the war ended. Yes, Mary, and that's what I was talking to Ray Reynolds on the phone earlier on. Prefabs, what's wrong with prefabs? Now, these, as Ray was telling me earlier, were put up just after the war because we didn't have enough houses. And they were only supposed to be there for 5 or 6 years, you know, while they built more houses. But people didn't want to leave them. They loved them. I think there was the last ones I saw were in Peckham. Peckham prefabs. Let's have a look. Peckham prefabs. Look at here you go. Look at this. Look at this. I've just found this. The most expensive prefab in Britain. Dilapidated post-war bungalow, a prefab bungalow in Peckham that's been empty for 13 years, sells for nearly £1 million. And there's a picture of it. And yeah, they look a bit old-fashioned now, those prefabs. But if they're still watertight and that, and they're not damp, why not? Why not? I mean, I don't know. Did he knock it down and build a house, or did he just live in it? Oh, yes, it could be converted into flats. I guess that's why they did it. They bought it like that. But those prefabs were perfectly right. People were very happy in those. And I'm sure they do still exist in places. I really do. Gavin says... I think you should play the piano again, Chris. You should sing a song. Oh, no, no singing today, dear. I don't think we're going to do any singing today. I tell you what I am getting a lot of. Still getting a lot of messages from young ladies wanting to be my friend and sending me filth, dear. Filth, trying to be my friend on Facebook. I'm getting, seriously, I'm getting about 10 a day now. I don't know why Facebook can't sort that out. Keith says, my mum squared in a prefab. She said it was the best years of her life. There you go. There's nothing wrong with them. So why don't the government and people stick these things up, sort out the houselessness? And I'll tell you why. Because a lot of them own properties and they know if a lot of houses get built, then the rents will come down. And that's the truth of it. I know that myself. If they started building hundreds of houses around it, I'd have to take my rents down a bit. That's just how it is. And I think that's got a lot to do with it. Anyway, well, close the lines now, boys and girls. I'm going to do today's birthdays. And we'll see whose birthday it is today. First of all, happy birthday to someone I went to school with, actually. Probably the only one that I'm in contact with at the moment. Mark Weller. And there's a little picture. Now, is that your baby or are you a granddad now, you old bastard? Let's have a look. That can't be your baby. Are you a granddad? Mark is a granddad. Wow. Happy birthday to you, Mark. So you must be 54 today, I would guess. Were you in front or behind me? I think you must be 54. Happy birthday to Mark, okay, who I went to school with. London Oratory School we went to together. Sergio, we used to sit together at Geography, didn't we? Geography with Mark Reddington. What happened to him? Are you still in contact with Mark Reddington? Do you remember him? Sergio Gustavo Bataka is 38 years old today. Isn't that a sexy name, Sergio? Happy birthday, Sergio. Paul Duffy's birthday day. Happy birthday, Paul. and Marcus V. Agar. There's another birthday today. Let's sing the song then. This is the only song you're getting out of me today, I'm afraid. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Mark, Sergio, Paul and Marcus, enjoy the rest of your birthdays, okay? Tonight, it's a Wednesday night, so I'll be hosting karaoke this evening at the King's Head. Sorry, not karaoke. I'll start that again. It's a Wednesday night tonight, so I'll be hosting our regular Wednesday quiz at the King's Head Theatre Bar in Upper Street, Islington. Starts at 8:30 and finishes at 10:30. We've got four rounds altogether. There's two lots of questions. There's one question round, which is just like general knowledge and current affairs. There's a picture round. There's a theatre round, which is like all theatre questions and musical stuff. And there's a music round. Tonight's music round is... Can I remember or not? I don't know. I can, actually. I can't remember what it is now. It could be titles beginning with A. So the title of all the answers begins with the letter A. I might be wrong about it. I can't remember what it is. No, I won't say that. I can't remember what it is. Maybe I can look it up. 1 minute. Maybe I can look it up for you. There's no cheating. It just gives you a little bit of a chance to perhaps prepare some stuff. Hang on. Music. Where is it? Quiz music. So what are we on? Week 20. 24, 22, 23, 24, 25. Is it 25? Yeah, I think it's titles beginning with the letter A. I'm pretty sure that's it. Titles beginning with the letter A. Okay, so that's your music round tonight. It's very, very easy going. We don't take anything too seriously in there. I like a little bit of a chat on the microphone, as you can probably guess. And we do have a bit of a laugh. Starts at 8:30, finishes at 10:30. Get there at 8 o'clock if you want a table. Okay, or even better still, ring ahead now. Ring ahead now to book a table. That's at the King's Head Theatre Bar, Upper Street, Islington, every Wednesday night tonight from 8:30. Thank you very much. Enjoy the rest of your Thursday. And I'll see you for another show very soon. Thanks so much for listening. Cheerio now.